Hey everybody, what's going on? My name's Alex. Welcome back to my little corner of the internet. Today I want to talk about the Motley Crue, Def Leppard, Poison, Joan Jett Stadium Tour. One of the comments I got on the Bon Jovi video that I did was, I'm comparing a 60-year-old man to a 35-year-old man using that clip of You Give Love a Bad Name from the Wembley show. And I'm going to do a comparison video on some more recent Bon Jovi stuff in another video, and we'll take a look at that. But what I thought would be really interesting for this video would be to take the most hotly anticipated stadium tour of 2022 with all of these great bands and see how their singers sort of measure up to how we remember them in their heyday and see how they're doing recently. So this stadium tour was originally booked for, I think, 2020, and then obviously COVID happened, and now it's finally happening in 2022. So the first show is happening in Atlanta, Georgia, in just over a couple of months' time, and we've got Joan Jett, Poison, Def Leppard, and Motley Crue. And what I thought we'd do, we'd take a look at some of these bands' biggest songs and see how they compare, because all of these singers are roughly the same age as John Bon Jovi, who just turned 60. Joan Jett is the oldest at 63. Bret Michaels is 59. Joe Elliott is 62 or 61, and Vince Neil is early 60s as well, I think 62. So let's have a look. The three that I've got here for Joan Jett, Poison, and Vince Neil are cell phone footage, and the Def Leppard one is from a live DVD. So take that with a grain of salt, because obviously some things may be overdubbed on that one. But I think it's going to be interesting just to see like the energy of these bands' performances and how these singers sound compared to, you know, some of the you know, less positive reviews that Bon Jovi have been getting. And it'd be interesting to see like the energy of the band as well. So let's start with Joan Jett. So this is at a New York State Fair from June last year. So relatively recent. Let's check it out. Here we go. I Love Rock and Roll. All right, okay, so first thing that I noticed is that she sounds vocally pretty good, you know? Joan Jett, probably the least technical singer of all of these singers on this tour and in this video, but that doesn't necessarily matter, is that she's still delivering the sound that she became famous for. And whether or not it's that kind of like laid-back, sultry, thick punk rock vocal, she's still delivering it. It sounds nice. I don't think there's a lot of energy on stage, but it's one of those things where there are times you might just pick up the energy of the crowd, or, you know, and you're just like, all right, we're just going to be cool and rock out on stage. It's going to be low energy, but we know we're cool, you know. But yeah, she sounds really good. And I think it's going to be a cool opener. Like Joan Jett, she's got so many great songs, you know. I Love Rock and Roll, Bad Reputation, I Hate Myself for Loving You. Great, great songs, but she's always retained that kind of gnarly, laid-back punk rock groove with her voice, and it works really, really well for her. So I think you know what, Joan Jett, you're kicking ass, and I'm looking forward to that. Again, the oldest of our entries on this tour. So now we're going to check out Poison, Bret Michaels and his mystical, magnificent headband. People give Bret a lot of crap, and I think it's very unfair because the guy is just positive power, man. Like, he doesn't do things by half measures. If he comes in, whether it's a country album, a rock album, whatever, like, Bret is there and he is committed, and you've got to applaud him for that. So Poison themselves, they didn't really kind of tour a lot for quite a while. They start touring again properly in 2017, 2018, I think. But I know for a long time that they'd only really kind of do private shows, and their appearance on the touring circuit was kind of limited. Let's check out how they sound now. Yeah. First thing I want to point out is how super healthy the entire band look. Like, I know CC's been clean for like 25 years now, but to see the guy bristle with that vibrance of energy and that lust for life, and his guitar playing is just on another level now as well. It was easy to rip on him back in the 80s, but like, the guy is a proper player now, and oh, it's great. Let's check it out. Oh, he's off! Man, like, feeling the energy off of that through my computer screen is intense. Like, everyone's on fire, everyone's looking super healthy, Brett sounds really, really good. And again, Poison, maybe not the most technically demanding of sort of vocal lines from the 80s, if you think about some of the more demanding vocals that, you know, that came out from that time. But, like, he is hitting the pitch, he is in tune, he has got the power. And his voice sounds rich, and it sounds great, and he's also bringing that energy to the stage as well as that. Do you see that, like, little shuffle that he was doing as he was moving around? Like, the guy is committed, and the band sound fantastic. I could watch this all the time. I could watch this entire show. Poison are going to give people a run for their money. I think they're going to be the sleeper on the bill. People will be like, oh yeah, I'll check them out for Every Rose Has Its Thorn. And they are going to put up some stiff competition, I think. There is a bundle of energy here and a bundle of, you know, capability that Poison have. I think very, very underrated now as a live act seeing this. One to watch out for, Poison, I think, on the live circuit. I think they're going to surprise a lot of people. Nice work, guys. Looking forward to that. Def Leppard now. So, as I said, this is on the London to Vegas DVD, so this is recorded in 2018, 2019. So there may be overdubs, there may be some mystical editing work, but I think it's a really good representation of how Def Leppard sound, because I saw them in 2019, and they were phenomenal. Like, so good, so tight, and so clean. Let's hear how Pour Some Sugar On Me sounds live.
Step inside, walk this way, you and me, babe.
Before we go any further, the power of that sound, like the how big and alive and vibrant the guitars are. They may be doing something you know, pretty clever with the guitars. Maybe they're putting them in stereo output to give them that extra boost, but that's what Def Leppard are kind of renowned for. That they, like, lots of kind of not trickery with guitars, but on their albums, guitars were multi-layered. But what they're doing here is that it's two guitarists on stage. It's the bass player. There may be a keyboard player off to the side somewhere for some songs. But just the power and of just five guys on stage, man, sounds great.
Love is like a bomb, baby, come and get it on. Living like a lover with a red iPhone. Looking like a tram, like a video ram. Demolition woman, can I beat her?
Yeah. Okay, cool. So a couple of things I want to point out here. First of all, the backing vocals are super strong here. No backing tapes, just the three guys delivering the backing vocals. But as well, you've got the bass player, Rick Savage. Let's just get a picture of him here. So what he's doing is he's delivering like a backing vocal under the verses. So where Joe's delivering that sort of more gravelly main line, Rick's got the undertone, just giving it a little bit more volume. And the thing is, when you take a vocal, or you know, put a little bit of reverb, maybe a smidge of delay and a tad of chorus on, just to spruce it up and give it that extra bit of, you know, feel good sauce. But having a second vocal under the lead vocal is really, really a smart idea. It gives it more life. I mean, that just sounds brilliant. It really does. Again, I know this is a live DVD, so, you know, there's probably had a bit of an editorial pass over it, but Joe is delivering the vocals. It's maybe he's delivering it with a much more gravelly tone these days. But again, you know, everybody here is now 35 years older than they were in their heyday. So it's unreasonable to not expect a change in the delivery of the vocals to adapt to a more mature voice. Now, the difference between something like Joe Elliott and the Bon Jovi stuff we looked at the other day is that, first of all, John was missing notes and there was no power behind John's voice either. There's also a lot to be said for the power and cohesion of a band, that all the three bands that we've looked at so far, they all sound like a band. Like, and I know that looking at the Bon Jovi stuff is mobile phone footage, but everybody, even like Poison and Joan Jett, they sound like a coherent unit, and Bon Jovi didn't sound like that. So it's not just necessarily pointing at a potential issue with this singer. It's about a cohesion as an entire unit as well. Because you can have a singer go off and do the stuff, which we're going to look at with Vince in a second. But the band unit has got to be, you know, has got to gel as well. And that's why, like, CC DeVille being, like, the health and shred monster he is so integral to Poison delivering that performance that they did. The Poison one was a couple of years old as well, so that perhaps wasn't as recent as some of these. Now, Vince, me old son. So I decided not to use some Motley Crue footage from 2015, mainly because it was just layered in backing tracks and overdubbed vocals and that kind of thing that I couldn't really justify using it. And bear in mind, that is 7 or 8 years old now as well. So this is from January this year. Cell phone footage again. So we've got R. Zoltan from Slaughter on the drums, legend. Let's see how our Vince sounds, okay? Right, okay. Okay, here we go. So, Vince, me old son. At least, like, barring any other criticism of the performances that we looked at with John, at least you can hear the words. Like, you know, like, John's diction is actually there. He's delivering the lines. It's just, but just this is kind of a little bit sharp and a little bit and very, very without power. But again, Vince was never one of the most lauded vocalists in the 80s anyway, and he always had that kind of high, relatively low bass, low mids thing about his voice. So, but what's really getting my goat here is the delivery of the vocals themselves. Okay, so right away when Vince doesn't sing, the backing tapes kick in on with the vocals and the band starts singing. Immediately, the vocal performance is lifted. Like, the problem is Vince, man. The problem is Vince. I don't know how to say this any other way. That when, the weight that he's carrying doesn't help either. And I don't want to, I'm not fat shaming here or whatever, but I used to be bigger. I used to be about 60 pounds heavier. I lost the weight, and I lost weight from my gut, and I lost weight from my chest. And even though I'm not a terrific singer, having the weight off of here and having the weight not from here pushing my diaphragm in, it allowed me to take deeper breaths. It allowed me to project more. My voice had more power. And this is what Vince is suffering from, I think. This is a large part of what's getting Vince. Just like, almost in a way, just like John, that they're not taking care of themselves, and this is what's pulling them down. I saw Jeff Tate in 2011 with Queensryche, and he was a bit all over the place. 2012, I've seen footage; he was genuinely poor. And then I saw Avantasia in 2019 in London, and he'd lost weight off his chest, he'd lost weight off of his torso. And sounded just fuller, man. And he sounded so good. And I'm wondering if this is what it's boiling down to, you know, with singers from the 80s and as they get older, that they're not taking care of themselves. Zoltan kicking ass there. Right, just on that, again, similar kind of thing on the second verse. There was a show earlier this year where Vince actually had to stop the performance. Vince Neil stops show. Okay, so let's just check this out. All right, here we go. So this is the Girls, Girls, Girls song where it's the last song and he admits his voice is shot. Now, this wasn't the last song in the set. This is only about four or five songs in, I believe. So let's see what happens. Okay, so at least he admits defeat in that situation, but you're about to embark on the most anticipated stadium tour of 2022, at least in the hard rock community, and as far as I can tell, you're not match ready, Vince. Just like John isn't match ready for what he's trying to do now. And I think, like I said, Joan's taking care of herself. Brett's taking care of himself. Joe's taking care of himself. Vince is not taking care of himself. John isn't taking care of himself. And this is what the problem is, I think. Or I believe. Okay? I heard some rumors that, you know, people have said in the comments that John has had COVID, which obviously is going to take a period of recovery, and the speculation that, you know, maybe there's something else going on as well that we don't know about. Either way, I wish him a very speedy and healthy recovery. I'd love to see him get back to that point. Like I said, John, Vince, take care of yourselves, man. So guys, what other singers do you think have taken care of themselves and have maintained their voice over the decades? Who do you think has maybe perhaps let it slip a little bit and isn't delivering what they should be delivering for the ticket prices? Leave your suggestions in the comments below. My name's been Alex. This has been My Little Corner of the Internet. Thanks for watching. I'll see you all next time. Take care. Bye for now.